I want to say a few words about Glen's flow law and the shear stress equation. Now, glaciology is an interesting discipline, partly because people come at it from lots of different directions. A lot of people get into glaciology through maths and physics. Other people get into it through field-based disciplines like geography and geology. A lot of my students are worried at the beginning that there are going to be lots of equations for them to learn, lots of maths in this module. And there really isn't much maths in this module at all. It's not that kind of module. But there are two equations that I say right from the beginning it's worth knowing about and worth remembering. And those are Glen's flow law and the shear stress equation. What are they? Glen's flow law tells us about how much a block of ice will deform depending upon how much stress or force is applied to it. With most things, if you apply a stress or a force to something, the amount of deformation that you get is a function of how much force you apply. The more I squeeze, the more deformation, the more compression I get. Well, that's true of ice, and what Glen's flow law does is say, well, how much compression or how much deformation will you get if you increase the amount of force which is being applied? The equation looks like this. E equals A times tau to the power n. Now, equations look scary sometimes because there are all these notations and figures. Don't worry about that. The two equations that we're going to be looking at in this module, they're simply descriptions of how lists of things connect to each other. So E is simply the symbol for the amount of strain or deformation that we're talking about. So the amount of strain is equal to this lot over here. And this lot over here is also pretty straightforward. Tau, Greek symbol tau, but any symbol would do, but tau is what we can conventionally use. Tau is the amount of force that we're applying, the amount of stress that we're applying to the ice. So what this is saying already, you can see, is that the amount of deformation that you get is equal to something including the amount of stress that you apply. Now that makes sense, that's common sense. The harder you push, the more deformation you get. The less hard you squeeze, the less deformation you get. Now, when you think about that in a real-world situation, you can also see it's pretty common sense that it depends on what it is that you're trying to squash. So when I'm trying to squash my plastic bag, it's a fairly soft thing. It doesn't take very much pressure, doesn't take very much stress to move it anyway. Whereas if I'm trying to deform this can, it takes a bit more stress to generate strain. And if I had something... very, very solid, then I'd have to really apply a lot of stress to generate very much strain at all. So the hardness of the material determines how much strain we're going to get in response to any amount of stress. A is the hardness term, or the hardness parameter. In ice, cold ice is generally harder than warm ice. Warm ice is softer. There are other things as well that control it, like chemical composition, impurities in the ice, but temperature is the main control on ice hardness. So we refer to A as the temperature-dependent hardness parameter. So the amount of strain you get is a function of how hard you push and how hard the material itself is. Now, what Glen discovered by doing his experiments applying stress to blocks of ice and measuring the amount of deformation is that this term up here, the flow law exponent, which he wrote, we've written down as n in this equation, well, he found that that comes out to a number somewhere around 3. So we're going to replace the n with a 3, and we're going to say E equals A times tau cubed. So the strain goes as the cube of the stress. Now, what that means is that if we increase the stress a little bit, we increase the strain a lot. So the strain is a function of the hardness of the material, the stress we apply, but a cubic exponent of the stress that we apply. The harder we push, the more deformation we get. So that's Glen's flow law. The amount of deformation you get in the ice depends on how hard the ice is and how hard you push. But the amount you push is really important because a small difference in the amount of stress that you're applying can make a big difference to the amount of strain that you get. Glen's flow law. Now, the shear stress equation follows directly on from that, because this term here, the stress, well, we wonder now, well, where does that come from? What makes that? Where does that come from? What are the components of stress? We're interested in the movement. We know that we understand the hardness. What's this stress term? Well, the stress, tau, is given by a and this is the shear stress equation, rho g h and the sine of alpha. More numbers. Let's explain those in a bit more detail. So just to explain the terms first of all, tau, shear stress as opposed to normal stress. So the shear stress is rho gh sine alpha. Rho is simply the density of ice, 0.9 grams per centimetre cubed. G is the force of gravity, 9.8 metres per second per second. And h is the height or thickness of the ice. So we've got the density of the ice, we've got the force of gravity, and we've got the thickness or the amount of ice. Combining those together, that's essentially the weight of the ice, the density, force of gravity, and the thickness. So the shear stress is given by the weight of the ice multiplied by sine alpha. Alpha, that's the gradient of the ice surface. So rho gh sine alpha, the weight of the ice and the gradient of the surface. Let's explain that in just a little bit more detail. So Glen's flow law tells us that the strain or deformation in the ice is a function of the hardness of the ice, it depends on temperature, and the applied stress, the force driving that deformation. The applied stress, where's that come from? Well, the shear stress equation tells us that the stress is rho gh sine alpha. So what's that? Well, here's the situation that we might be dealing with. So here's the substrate under the glacier. Here's the glacier. Here's the surface of the glacier. A little chap there stood with his ice axe. And what we're asking is, for a point in the ice, or a block of ice within the ice column there, what's the shear stress, the sideways force, if you like, leading to deformation within that block of ice? When you're talking about shear stress, you could also be talking about the shear stress at the base of the glacier, which is driving sliding at the bed. But for now, following on from Glen's flow law, talking about blocks of ice being deformed, let's think about the shear stress acting on this block of ice within the glacier. So tau equals rho gh sine alpha. Rho is the density of ice, g is the force of gravity, and h is the thickness of ice bearing down on that point that we're interested in. So like we said before, rho gh is essentially the weight of the ice on that point. Alpha is the gradient of the ice surface there. It's that gradient which is driving the forward motion. If the surface was flat, all of the force would be a vertical force. You'd have a normal stress crushing the ice downwards, but there'd be no shear stress moving it sideways. So that gradient is important. So as that gradient increases, the sine of alpha increases from zero when it's horizontal to higher and higher values, up to 100% if it were vertical. So the shear stress here increases with increasing thickness of ice above the point and with increasing gradient. So how much of the weight of the ice is generated as shear stress as opposed to normal stress depends on the gradient of that surface, and the shear stress is a function of the overburden pressure, the thickness and weight of the ice, and that surface gradient. So those two equations, Glen's flow law and the shear stress equation, they are pretty much the only two equations that we're going to use in this whole module. Some people, probably some people watching this video who aren't doing our module, will say that this is outrageous and you can't possibly study glaciology with only two equations, and certainly not explaining them in those common sense terms. Some people would want a lot more maths, a lot more numbers, a lot more computation to get us into the nitty-gritty of glacier mechanics and glacier modelling. That's fine, we could go that way, but this module isn't going to go that way. We will come back to these equations later on when we start looking at how glaciers move and how the shape of an ice sheet, the surface profile of an ice sheet, relates to the movement, the dynamics, the bed characteristics, the surface characteristics, and the characteristics of the interior of the glacier. But for now, I just want you to be aware of these two equations, Glen's flow law, the shear stress equation. If you're a proper glaciologist, then I expect you should have one of them tattooed on one arm and one of them tattooed on the other arm, so you can never forget them. And we'll come back and we will revisit these later on.